to our channel. I'm Andrea.
I'm Alejo.
And we've been living on our sailboat for the past about 20 months. We live on a Lagoon 420. It's a sailing catamaran. And today we're gonna be giving you a tour of our electric system. So if you guys wanna see a tour of like the entire boat, you guys can check out the video here that I'm showing up here or up here, I'm not sure. But today we will be focusing only on the electric system, as that is the heart of our boat, right? We also have two battery banks in the starboard side of our boat
to create 248 volt banks. Got a first step up.
Hakuna Matata. It means no worries.
We are going more into depth about our solar power system, our inverter, our generator, and how we make this boat work, because everything is electric except our engines.
The only thing that we have that is propane is the barbecue, which is outside, completely separated from the boat. Everything else is
electric.
That's including the water maker, including the oven, air conditioning units, everything which we're going to talk about today. We will be sharing with you how much we have in terms of solar, how much each appliance consumes in terms of watts, right? The electric consumption, and how our batteries have worked for us, our lithium batteries, and all about that. So let's get started. Let's start with our solar panels and let's go up there. And sorry guys, we are doing laundry right now. So guys, we have six solar panels. Each one is of 295 watts. However, they don't have a 100% efficiency. They're efficient at about 280 watts.
Each panel is 52 volts connected in series. It makes 316 volts and it goes straight to our MPPT controller. Also guys, how the panels are mounted into the bimini of the boat is by this plastic. So it's good because it leaves a little bit of space beneath, underneath the panel, so they can breathe and they don't get like super hot. And also we don't have a solar arch. So let me show you how they mounted the panels. They have like rails. So there's underneath here, there's a rail like this right here. And then another rail right here like this. Underneath the panels, this is how they are mounted. They have like a bracket holding two panels and they are attached here to the bimini. It's pretty simple, works out. We have been a category 2 hurricane or 3 and they haven't flown away. No movement at all. So yeah, it's pretty good.
So guys, this is where the heart of our entire boat sits at. Our inverter is right here and our entire boat just runs off the inverter. This means that we always have AC power. Now the solar panels send the energy to the MPPT, which is the red SMA panel that you guys see right there. And the MPPT then sends the energy to the inverter. This MPPT actually converts the energy from 316 volts. It converts it into AC power, which is going to be 220 to 240 volts. Once we have the energy on the inverter, if we are using energy, obviously the inverter sends the energy, whether we're using water maker, air conditioning, or just cooking, or, you know, washing the dishes or whatever it is that we're doing. Well, not washing the dishes. Using the dishwasher, then it sends all the energy to the dishwasher. Now, if we're not using that energy, it then sends it to the lithium batteries, which we're gonna show you guys on the other room. We also have two battery banks in the starboard side of our boat, and they are the ones that run the 12 volts in the boat. This means that they run the navigation systems, it runs the, for instance, like the anchor lights, the navigational lights. So normally, if we turn on the starboard engine, we are able to charge that 12 volt bank system. But whenever we're not, let's say we're anchored right now, and we're not turning on the starboard engine, Then at that point, we have an AC to DC converter, and that is what's going to change the energy from 220, change it into a 12 volt so that it can always keep those 12 volt battery banks charged. The other thing that goes to our inverter is our generator. We have a 4 kilowatt generator, and this generator, we don't really use it that often. We use it when we have a high power consumption. Let's say we're running the air conditioners both day and night, and or we're making water. Normally, those are the two things that use the most energy. But most of the time, we're just always running off the solar panels. It's still good to have it because, let's say, for instance, if we have 6 cloudy days in a row and we want to make water and, you know, the batteries are pretty low, we don't want to lower our batteries more than 10%. And so that's when we would turn on the generator. Now we are going to go to our lithium batteries. That's our 48 volt bank. And Alejo is going to explain that to you guys. So let's go.
So we are here in the port stern room where our lithium is installed. So we have a 48 volt bank that's separate from like the original 12 volt bank from the boat. Our bank is 170 amp hour, 24 volt batteries. They are from big battery. And so we connected them in parallel, then in series, to create two 48 volt banks. So this is one 48 volt bank, and this is another one. And this goes to our inverter. In total, we have 340 amp hours of 48 volts. That's equivalent to 1,300 and
1,360 at those volts.
Okay. That is equivalent to 1,360 amp hours in 12 volts. So yeah, that's a big battery bank. Maybe in the future we'll add a little bit more, we'll see. If you guys have been following us for the last couple of videos, so we changed the batteries around 6 to 8 months. We had a LG Chem battery, and that battery went bad. One of the cells inside the pack got like unbalanced and the whole pack like stopped working.
10-year warranty, big company that they would help you, and they don't do anything for you. So here we are with what, how much is this battery worth? Like $10,000?
And we couldn't do like warranty or anything, so yeah. So we decided to go with big battery. Our experience with big battery has been very good. Well, they have worked perfectly. The good thing is this is LiFePO4 like cells, so it's like lithium iron phosphate. It's not like the LG Chem, which was NMC, which is more unstable. It can catch on fire. These cells don't catch on fire. Make sure to subscribe if you like this video, if you are looking into like switching into lithiums, or if you're gonna get a boat and you wanna know more about lithiums. I'm gonna be doing another video in the couple next weeks about comparing other brands of lithium, and also I'll be installing a brand new BMS on these batteries. So I'm gonna be taking them apart and seeing what's inside, how they're working, and just to make sure that everything is all right. So we can see the quality of big battery after 8 months of usage. And I'm gonna be installing a BMS made by Imus. I'm gonna be switching the BMS on the batteries because our inverter requires a CAN bus communication cable between batteries and inverter, just to like have a more accurate state of charge, and that way the solar can just like put a lot of power without having like too many restrictions.
So guys, now we're gonna talk about our power consumption in the entire boat, and we're gonna start with what consumes the most energy, which is our water maker. And so since we are an off-grid boat, we spend a lot of time in remote places. We don't have to actually go to marinas to get water, or we don't have to, you know, we are a self-sustained boat pretty much. So in terms of both water and electricity, we do pretty good. And so our water maker, it actually consumes 2,530 watts. Now that obviously is the maximum. That does depend on how much water and how much pressure we're making. I won't be going too in depth on our water maker because this video is focused only on our electric system. We will be making another video on the water systems, but for now, all you need to know is how much it consumes. Let's go to the other appliances. So let's talk about the kitchen area. Now we have our stove, which is a two burner stove. One of the burners is actually a double burner, which means like it can be small or it can be a big burner. And the maximum that the stove consumes is actually 1,800 watts. Again, that is the maximum, and that does depend on the temperature we're using. We also have our oven here, and our oven actually consumes 1,650 watts. Again, just like with everything else, that depends on the temperature, because normally if you put a low temperature, it will actually just turn on and turn back off, just to make sure that it keeps that low temperature, but it's not constantly consuming those 1600 watts. We also have our dishwasher, and our dishwasher actually consumes 650 watts. That is assuming that we use eco mode. Here we have our refrigerator, and our refrigerator actually uses 90 watts. And it's the same thing as the oven. It actually turns on and off. It's very easy to keep cool. And the same thing goes for the freezer. We have two freezers on the boat, and this is our main freezer. This one actually consumes 150 watts. And we have a second freezer in one of our bathrooms, which is like a storage room. I'll show you guys. So the second freezer, which is the one that we have here, we like to have a second freezer for storage, and this one actually uses about 45 watts. Again, same thing, turns on and off, so it's not really like a high consuming appliance. So below our sofa, we have our first air conditioning unit, which is a 16,000 BTU air conditioning unit, and that one actually consumes 1,050 watts, and that is when you have it full on using the 16,000 BTUs. Now, it also has an eco mode, and that one, when you put it on eco mode, it only consumes 200 watts, and it goes down to like 3,900 BTUs. And the good thing about this air conditioning units is that they have a soft start, so they don't like pull that huge electrical consumption when you turn them on, which is what most of the air conditioning units do. So right here we have our second air conditioning unit, and this is the unit that we use for our room. We never really turn on all three air conditioning units at the same time. Usually we turn on this one when we're gonna go to sleep, and we run it for the entire night. We run it in eco mode, and this is a 10,000 BTU air conditioning unit. And this one actually consumes only 680 watts, and that is when you're using it to the maximum. We also have this same unit in the opposite room of the boat, which is the port bow room, and that one has the same air conditioning unit. If we run all three air conditioning units at the same time, let's think about like worst situation, we are able to keep the entire boat super cool. But what we normally do is that we just lock the rooms, we lock the cabins, like we close the doors on all the cabins and run the salon, which is where we spend most of the time when we're working, and that's what we have done during summer. We especially turn on the air conditioning units mostly for the dogs, because they get really hot. Obviously they're very hairy, and so when we turn on the AC, it just cools the boat right away, and we have a super comfortable office for us and a home for the dogs. So and one quick tip for you guys, that if you're interested in getting air conditioning units for your boat, before we move on to the washer, is that the air conditioning units, obviously you need a pump for the air conditioners, which is going to be running the entire time you run the ACs. And normally people buy brands like Dometic, but the bad thing about those water pumps is that they consume about 800 watts. So even if you're running your AC units, which have super low power consumption, you're still using a lot of energy on the pump. So we have a Iwaki water pump. It actually, this is a small one. The one we have installed for the air conditioning units is a little bit bigger, but this small one consumes from 45 to 50 to 57 watts. The one that is a little bit bigger, it might range from 100 to let's say 120 watts. So it's still significantly less than if you're using one of those big brands that is consuming 800 watts, and you know, you might as well not install air conditioning units that are going to have a low power consumption. Our washer also consumes about 500 watts, and obviously we do connect a lot of things, like we connect the electric scooters when we have to charge them. We're always working on our computers. As you guys know, we run a business, an online business. We're always like plugging in computers, our cell phones, like the blender, the rice cooker. So there's a bunch of other things that I'm not taking into account. We're only mentioning the appliances that have a high power consumption. And I hope this helps give you a better idea about how much we actually consume in terms of our entire boat. So if we wanted to put together the perfect electric system for a boat, what would you put, babe?
I would go with the LG Neon Art solar panels, or Panasonic, like the ones we have. But I would get, instead of panels that are 295 watts, I would get like the ones that are like 340 or something.
I think we're pretty happy in terms of the lithium batteries, as we mentioned to you guys. One of the companies that we would not recommend is a company from our generator, Whisper Power. We had a terrible experience with them in terms of the customer service. LG Chem, with the customer service, we were not that happy with them either. But we were very happy with our inverter. The SMA inverter is really good. One of the things that you have to look out for is the warranty with the companies that you guys are going with, because believe me, they will, something might happen to them at some point, and you really want to have that customer service, someone to be able to talk to, someone to guide you through the process on how to fix it, you know, when you're far away or like not having anyone to help you out. It's really good to be able to have someone on that you can just give a call on the line. And SMA for us, they did an incredible job. They were, it was super easy to get in touch with them, super easy to get great customer service.
Also, when you're purchasing like electronics for your boat, make sure that the warranty does cover if they are installed in boats, because that's what happened with us for the LG battery. I guess the previous owner didn't tell LG that they were gonna put it on a boat.
And that's one of the things that we checked with Big Battery. They do cover us, they do give us warranty if something happens to the batteries and if something goes wrong. They know that they are installed in a boat and they are going to cover them at any point in time if something were to happen. So I think that's about it for this video. We really hope you guys enjoyed it, and we hope that you were able to find some valuable information from everything that we shared with you today. Don't forget to
subscribe and hit the thumbs up.
Yep, and make sure to click on the little bell, click all notifications so that you receive notifications whenever we upload a new video. As we mentioned, we will be uploading some videos in the near future, once where Alejo is comparing the low-cost batteries that we have right now, which are the big battery ones, compared to big brands such as
Reliant and Battleborn.
And in other videos, we will be doing the installation of the BMS on our on our batteries. So make sure to subscribe and to hit the bell, and we will see you guys on the next video. Bye.